On This Week in Enterprise Tech, is the government playing in the big leagues with grammar school security? And what's happening at DARPA? It's all next. Twyatt on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 145, recorded June 19th, 2015. Robots and sharks and snakes. Oh my. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by Braintree. If you're working on a mobile app and searching for the right payments API, check out the Braintree V.0 SDK. With one simple integration, you get every way to pay. To learn more and to try out the sandbox, go to braintreepayments.com/enterprise. And by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 100-plus job sites, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire the right candidates fast. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. Welcome to Twyatt, This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. But of course, I ain't guiding you by myself. I've got my good friends and co-hosts with me, starting with Mr. Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Brian, how is the geek in paradise?
I am over the moon. I just started moving gear into a new lab, and we're going to be building open source science instruments and concentrating on embedded systems so that we can build all kinds of really cool stuff and donate the design to the world.
Yeah, the last time you were on, we were talking about your smart net in Maui. Now you're working on the next generation of open source. Seriously, Cheebert, what don't you do over there?
I don't sleep.
Good. Okay, good. No, we're on the same page there. Also, a man who doesn't sleep. I don't think he slept since like 1960. Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, you are not on the other coast today. Where are you coming from? Oh, you're muted. He doesn't think he's muted. He's not muted on our side? No. Are you sure?
He's on Skype 1. I've got Skype 1
loaded up. Curtis, we don't have any audio from you whatsoever. Carl? Okay, Carl is muted, so... this is...
Testing?
There you go.
Can you hear me?
Oh, you're, like, way on and off. Keep talking.
What's going on here? Testing. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2.
Keep giving us audio.
Testing. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Testing. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2.
Okay, it seems to be coming through now. Let's just take it and see what happens.
Okay, let me throw it to you again. Come back to me. A man who also hasn't slept since 1950, Mr. Curtis Franklin from Information Week Radio. Curtis, you're not on the other coast today. Where are you?
Well, I'm still on the other coast. I'm just in a hotel room on the other coast doing some traveling for Information Week and for some other purposes, but glad to be with you, courtesy of Hilton Wi-Fi.
Well, thanks, Hilton. Now, we've got an action-packed show. We're actually going to be speaking with Karl Auerbach, who was working with the DARPA Robotics Challenge. So if you want to know what it takes to put together a, next-generation DARPA Robotics Challenge, you may want to stay tuned. But first, let's jump straight into the blips. This first one is all about backdooring the backdoors. A second-year computer science student at King's College in London has discovered a flaw in the demo version of eDetective, which is used by over 100 governments and law enforcement agencies around the globe to spy on mobile and internet devices. Mustafa Al-Bassam, a former member of LulzSec, announced that a script in the web root allows for unauthenticated users to read arbitrary files on the system and has published a proof of concept on GitHub. The Decision Group, the company behind eDetective, advertises their product as an enterprise-level network forensics tool to protect sensitive data from leakage, though their bullet points make it pretty clear that they're selling it on its ability to capture, sniff, and reassemble packets without client-side detection. Who would have thought that introducing a man-in-the-middle attack into vital network infrastructure could have negative consequences?
Oracle is going to the cloud. Oracle is seeing the future, and it looks like a cloud. On June 17th, Oracle announced its earnings for its 2015 financial fourth quarter, and this gave everybody an opportunity to evaluate how things are going with its cloud computing plan. The 17% year-over-year decline in traditional new software licenses, the company's original core business, can't be ignored because it shows that customers are turning from Oracle's original business model and using more of the recent technology beyond the corporate data center. SaaS and PaaS revenues grew at a 34% constant currency rate in Q4, but Oracle expects that revenue growth rate to jump to around 60% in constant currency in the new fiscal year. Licenses down, cloud up. It's a trend Oracle seems intent on taking advantage of for the long term.
Time Warner Cable may face net neutrality complaint from a webcam hoster. So Commercial Network Services is a company trying to wiggle out of paying interconnection fees to Time Warner Cable and has filed suit for violation of the FCC's new net neutrality rules. At issue is that interconnection fees aren't illegal and they are just trying to get a free ride, maybe. What the FCC rules do allow are complaints if they think the charges are unreasonable. I should point out that in this case, streaming video at the edge provider is what soaks up the bulk of the transit fees, which leads me to believe that while Time Warner thinks it's on solid ground, I think this isn't as cut and dry as everybody might think.
What are the most reliable hard drives in real life? The answer may surprise you. How's that for clickbait? Now, online backup service Blackbase has released their hard drive reliability stats for the first quarter of 2015, and the results are interesting. Blackblaze has 42,749 hard drives spinning in their data center, spread over 21 different drive models from four different manufacturers. That includes 23,052 HGST, 17,522 Seagate, 140 Toshiba, and 1,540 Western Digital drives. Compiling the failure rates, Blackblaze's most reliable drive came from HGST, now a Western Digital company, with a failure rate hovering near 1% for most of the drives, except for their Megascale 4000.B with a 20.29% failure rate of 3,100 drives. The worst performing drives came from Seagate, with a failure rate running between 7.2% and 25.4%. In all cases, the enterprise-rated drives performed the best.
IBM looks to Spark for the future. IBM is making a major commitment to the future of Apache Spark. IBM will offer Apache Spark as a service on Bluemix, commit 3,500 researchers to work on Spark-related projects, donate IBM System ML to the Spark ecosystem, and offer courses to train 1 million data scientists and engineers to use Spark. The key problem Spark resolves is access to data across the enterprise. A Spark-based system can seamlessly and transparently access and analyze any database without additional development delay. While Spark looks promising, nothing will come of it without sufficient numbers of data scientists to actually use it, and that's where training the 1 million people comes in. Ultimately, it falls to enterprises to make the best use of big data technology such as Spark, but IBM is making a big bet that Spark will help the industry make the most of big data.
OS X and iOS flaws let researchers into some very private data. Oops, another big bug in OS X is a biggie and could potentially get hackers access to users' keychain and OnePass data. The good news is the vulnerability was found in the laboratory, so not in the wild. What makes this more than a little scary is this vulnerability made it all the way through the Apple App Store and got the researchers access to a really scary collection of private data.
AT&T Wireless, now with unlimited fines. From the Wasn't This Handled Years Ago file, this past Wednesday, the FCC announced a $100 million fine against AT&T for throttling customers with unlimited data plans. According to the FCC, AT&T wireless customers who typically received 5 to 12 megabits per second downstream bandwidth were suddenly slowed to 512 kilobits per second after a nebulous cap. This throttling affected millions of customers, leading to the largest fine ever levied by the government agency. AT&T claims that the throttling is actually network management and that they have been fully transparent with their customers and therefore shouldn't be fined. But as Harold Feld, a senior vice president at a Washington consumer advocacy group, noted, this signals a new era of doing business in which you have to be upfront rather than trying to engage in a game of bait and switch. Folks, that does it for the blips. We're going to go ahead and jump straight into the bites. But first, let's go ahead and thank the first sponsor of This Week in Enterprise Tech, and it's Braintree. Now, if you are building a mobile app or searching for a simple payment solution, then you owe it to yourself to check out Braintree before you go any other route. I know there's going to be those among you who want to build your own solution. You want to roll your own financial transaction system. And that's fine. You can do that if you don't mind worrying about back-end security and your payment processor and all the little things that go with it. Yeah, you could go that way, or you could just get 10 simple lines from Braintree's SDK and be done with it. If you're a developer or just looking for an easy way to accept payments, then you're going to wonder how you did it without their V0 SDK. It's elegant code with clear documentation. You developers are going to love it. It's only 10 lines of in-app code, and you're ready to run. Code supports Android, iOS, and JavaScript clients. And their SDK is in 7 languages: .NET, Node.js, Java, Perl, PHP, Python, and Ruby. And with that simple snippet of code, you'll be able to accept all the payment types that you and your customers want, even 130-plus different global currencies. Braintree has the best in-class customer service. If you have a question, Braintree is always ready to answer it. And here's my favorite part. If you have any trouble with the integration, they'll actually have someone walk you through it. They'll stick with you to make sure that you do it right. Of course, Braintree knows that it's not enough to have easy-to-integrate code and top-notch customer service. They get that you're offering your financial services, and it's your reputation on the line. Known for their back-end security and their merchant protection, they use tokens so that your customer's financial information is never put at stake. You can't lose what you don't have, and that makes Braintree the fastest, easiest, and most secure way to pay ever. Now, here's what we want you to do. We want you to try Braintree. Braintree gives you that easy way to accept multiple payment types with that one integration. They're quick, they're knowledgeable, they've got developer support that you want, and they'll answer every question that you have. Start accepting Apple Pay, PayPal, Bitcoin, Venmo, cards, and whatever's next, all with their V.0 SDK. That's right. To learn more and for your first $50,000 in transactions fee-free, go to BraintreePayments.com/enterprise. That's BraintreePayments.com/enterprise. And we thank Braintree for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Let's go ahead and jump into the Enterprise Bites. Now, this is a story that we've been sitting on for a while. I know that we could have talked about it the last 2 weeks, but the three of us wanted to wait until there was a bit more substantial information rather than just hearsay. And of course, we are talking about the OPM hack. That's the Office of Personnel Management, basically the government's HR department. Now, Chiebert, before we get into the nitty-gritty of exactly what happened, what information does the OPM have that, say, I don't know, another country might want?
So when I first heard about the story, I thought it was the standard OPM records, which actually have an obfuscated social security number and, you know, basic information. But recent revelations show that they've actually leaked the contents of what's called the standard form 86. It is the form that all federal employees must fill out if they're going for a classified position. What's really scary about the SF-86 contents is it not only has your full social security number, your full date of birth right down to the time in certain cases, but it also has your parents' name, your parents' social security numbers, your entire history of where you live. Now, if you're going for one type of classifications, it's only about 7 years. But if you're going for much higher, I actually had to put down where and when I was born. So anyway, that's pretty scary stuff, and it has your entire work history. It is basically what a hacker would dream about getting, because you can create an entirely new identity from that. You can create loan applications. You could buy a house with that kind of information. It's bad, bad, bad juju.
Yeah, Chee, both of us have actually had to do a security clearance process. Yours was far, far more intrusive than mine. Mine was basically, where have you gone? What countries have you traveled to? Who have you come into contact with? But as you said, this Form 86, especially if you're going for a high security clearance, it's no longer identity theft. They have everything. They don't have to try to get more with your social security number. They know everything from everyone you know to every place you've ever been to who you've ever been in a relationship with. I mean, how do we make people understand how bad this is, other than just saying bad juju?
This is bad. Now that I know about this, I'm probably going to be writing to my senators and my representatives and to the OPM and say, hey, at the very, very least, you guys are going to buy me a lifetime supply of LifeLock. I think that's the absolute minimum that OPM should be doing. I think they should also be slammed with one heck of an audit, because this should never have happened. They are just behind the times. And, you know, when we go further on in the story, you're going to find out how scary this was, in that anyone with credentials into the OPM network could get to just about anyone's data. And that's how the hackers got in.
Curtis, let me ask you about this. I mean, this is something that you would expect a sloppily run enterprise to do, to have the HR systems, the HR database somehow get breached. It's not really what you expect from a government agency, or maybe it is what you expect from a government agency. I don't know. You can go either way. But in your mind, is there more of a breach than this? I mean, we've talked about a lot of breaches of the past years, where it's been credit cards, it's been social security numbers, it's been personally identifying information. But in most cases, that was a one-shot deal. If it was a credit card, you could get credit monitoring. If it was your social security, you could also get credit monitoring. Plus, you would go through your credit report to make sure no one else was trying to use it. With the kind of information that was contained within the OPM database, it's not just you anymore. It's anyone that you know. They've got all your points of contact, and now someone can pretend to be you.
Oh, no question. I mean, this is something that is enormous. And I'll tell you what else is enormous. The fact that, by all accounts, they were wandering around in that database for months before they were discovered, which means that there's no telling which other government systems they were able to gain access to through the information they discovered in the OPM database, and may even now be tripping lightly through the databases. This is the kind of breach that in physical terms would be the equivalent of a few battalions sneaking across the border and occupying Arizona for 10 months before anyone noticed that they had raised a foreign flag over all the buildings. I mean, this really is a huge deal. It would be a big deal no matter what organization it was taking place within. But for it to happen within the OPM for this long is simply mind-boggling.
The really scary part about this is it just keeps growing. And this is why we waited and waited and waited to cover this story, because it first started off with, 3 weeks ago, them saying, well, the OPM was breached. They talked, oh, it could be as bad as 4 million records, but we think it's just, you know, Social Security and names and maybe some personally identifying information. Then it became, oh, it may have actually been Form 86. Then we now know it's at least 14 million records. And in fact, there was a quote here from Representative Stephen Lynch, who, speaking to the Washington Post, said, once you start operating on the cancer, you find that it has spread to the other areas of the body. Speaking, of course, about the breach. And the subtext here is that this is just the tip of the iceberg. They're starting to unravel more and more of this breach, of this infection. And what they're realizing is they don't exactly know how big it is. Chee-Bert, this is the exact opposite of what we've been talking about the last year, this whole idea of 100% transparent failure. This is we're going to cover it up as long as we possibly can, and hopefully the American people will stop paying attention to it.
Now, this is a case where there needs to be some jail terms handed out for this. I mean, this, I cannot, I am mad enough that I'm starting to turn red here. This is one of those things that we absolutely positively need to put these people in jail to set the precedence that you cannot screw around with people's personal information like this. You know, I know government's supposed to be transparent, but come on now. You're not supposed to be that transparent. I actually have a tough time getting my own records out of OPM. Maybe I should just call the Chinese government so I can go and get a copy of my SF-86 that I, you know, my latest one. You know, it's like, come on, really?
Yeah, the Chinese government. Okay, well, first of all, no one has officially said that it's the Chinese government. A lot of security experts are saying it's probably the Chinese, probably a Chinese sponsored effort that took the records. But you're right. I think I could probably get a more detailed file on myself from the Chinese government than I could get from a FOIA request. Now let's dig a little bit deeper, because it's easy to say, okay, this was a breach, this was a hack attack, this was a one-time thing, it won't happen again. They'll shut all the doors that allowed this. But to go down on the even scarier level is that people are starting to realize that the entire architecture of OPM, and by the transitory principle, perhaps of more and more layers of government, invited the breach. That they were so poorly constructed, so poorly thought out, so stuck in an era of filing cabinets rather than network computers, that a breach was inevitable. In fact, we've got the director of OPM, Catherine Archuleta, who, under intense questioning from both Republicans and Democrats alike, basically told them that encryption wouldn't have helped because the system just, it can't handle it. We have no way to really use modern encryption, and therefore we couldn't tell you whether or not a more robust security system could have stopped the breach. Curtis, where do they go from here? I mean, they're essentially admitting that the networking system that they use to share some of the most sensitive information the government has tabs on is ridiculously easy to crack.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, they have basically said that there is no effective security on all of these records. Leads to a reasonable question about where there is effective security. And, you know, Brian was absolutely right. Someone needs to be held responsible. But we know from past experience that no one within the government is going to be held accountable. My guess is that not only will there not be any jail time, no one will lose their job. And that's one of the issues. There is no accountability. People can ride herd over systems that are completely dysfunctional. They can be the responsible manager and administrator for systems that are hacked, releasing the private information on millions of individuals, and they will suffer exactly zero career, civil, or legal consequences. And as long as that's the case, there really is no incentive for them to get it right.
Right. We've got some good comments in the chat room. JJ to the 4884 is saying that, you know, essentially this will turn an entire generation of people, of young up-and-coming adults, away from government service because they see what a debacle their security, information security is. We've also got PC Guy 8088, who is essentially saying this is one of those breaches where it's almost easier to say what has not been compromised rather than what has. But Chiebert, we were having a conversation about this a couple of days ago. The OPM hack is actually a little bit reminiscent of the Sony hack in that it was based on perimeter security. They had firewalls to keep people out, but once you got in, you could basically go anywhere. I mean, that's what bit Sony, and that's essentially what bit OPM, right?
Yeah, this is, I'm sorry, this is 1980s security. Not, you know, when I was in government service, you know, I designed better systems. Come on, we have the talent. OPM, you know, we had all these regulations. Why are we holding the private sector to a much, much higher standard than our internal security? When you're a private contractor working with the government, you've got this amazing volumes of regulations on how you do things, how you audit, how you do this and how you do that. What are you responsible for? And this is the jail term you're going to face if you screw up. Come on, eat your own dog food, for God's sakes. Apply the same rules, you know, FSMA, for God's sakes, or NISPOM. Use the same regulations that you've been ramming down the private sector's throat for decades and use it on your own freaking systems. Come on.
All right, guys. So we've sort of got the angst out. We know we're all upset. We're all a little ticked off about this actually happening. But I think it's time for us to start offering some advice. Of course, no one in the government's going to listen to this because, as Chee said, no one's really accountable for it. But this is a unique situation in that there's a lot of information, as we start to look at this, that shouldn't have been online in the first place. It should not have been available on the network. And this is the exact same thing that happened to Sony. There are certain records that don't need to be on a network. They don't have to be connected to the internet in any way, shape, or form that were out of convenience. So, of course, that's the first step. The first step is to go through the information that you actually have and decide what needs to be on and what doesn't. But there's something else here. And, Chee, I want to get your input on this. How do you fundamentally change the security of a system that can't be shut down? You can't just shut off OPM and turn off their databases until you get the security right. At the same time, it's still as breachable now as it was 3 weeks ago. So how do you start implementing a new security protocol that is going to offer you more protection while you're still using the network?
Actually, first off, OPM didn't go to an online system for SF-86s until about 6-7 years ago. Come on, air gap the broken system while you build a new one. It ain't that tough. And SF-86s aren't really big. You know, it's encoded data, a lot of stuff. You can move that to a smaller system. Take the older records off, take everything offline and only put the stuff you absolutely gotta have and put it on a modern system. Hadoop is more secure than what they're using. Come on. There's a lot of things you can do. This is not hard. Air gaps cannot be hacked. You know, you have to physically be in the building, and that's what you have 18-year-olds with M16s for. this isn't rocket science.
Curtis, maybe we can take a little bit of preventative medicine from this, from enterprises. We talk a lot about breaches. We talk a lot about hacks. But this whole, what do you do after you've been hacked? What do you do after you've been breached? Is something that we tend to gloss over. What would you say would be the good first step? So, of course, Chee and I have already talked about taking certain files offline, making sure that the information that doesn't need to be network accessible isn't network accessible. Get yourself into a secure system as fast as possible. But what else can you give? I mean, let's say this is not the OPM. Let's say that this is a mid-sized enterprise that has just been breached. They don't even know the extent of the breach yet they need to start securing what they do have left.
Well, I think that one of the big issues is that there are tools available that can help with this. Because one of the keys is assuming that you're going to have your perimeter cracked and then making sure that you have the systems in place that will let you know that you have been hacked as rapidly as possible. We've heard a lot about advanced persistent threats over the last decade. And there are all kinds of systems built around concepts that started with intrusion prevention, intrusion detection, that basically will tell you when there's anomalous behavior going on and allow you to identify breaches and remediate them as soon as possible. The real danger in OPM, as it was in Sony, isn't necessarily the fact that someone made it through the perimeter, but the fact that they were able to sit there and to get data, play around with data for months and months and months before anyone ever knew it. And let's be honest, they were discovered not through any activity of the OPM itself, but simply because a vendor came in and was doing a demonstration during a sales call. if that hadn't happened, that breach could still be ongoing. So I would say one of the key things is look at the available technology that's out there to figure out when you have a breach occurring so that you can identify it, shut it down, and do remediation before the major damage happens.
Fantastic. Gentlemen, we are going to be doing this story for quite a while longer. This story has legs. Now, I do want to end on this. I spoke to a couple of our security gurus about this story. I asked them if they wanted to come on the show, and they all said the same thing, which is, you don't really need me. This wasn't an advanced persistent threat. This wasn't some super advanced attack exploit. This was basically just a very poorly designed network with poorly designed security with poorly trained people. So, yeah, we don't know exactly where we're going to go with that. Let's go ahead and move on to a story that may actually bring hope to people in the enterprise. And that's Gartner telling people in the enterprise to go ahead and skip Windows 8 or 8.1 and go straight to Windows 10. Now, Gartner is basically saying that if you are thinking about migrating away from your Windows 7 systems, which not a lot of enterprises are because Windows 7 will be supported until 2020, then you should go ahead and skip 8.1 and go directly to 10, even if it means delays in your deployment strategy. Now, it identifies several areas in which Windows 10 is superior, including security, management, user experience, as well as a business-conducive app store. Now, since most companies haven't even thought about moving away from Windows 7 yet because of all the bad press around Windows 8.1, there's not a whole lot of buzz about this report, but it does strike on several key points that Microsoft is trying to make about Windows 10, specifically that it's going to be enterprise-friendly. Curtis, let me throw this to you first. No IT manager I know has even mentioned the thought about moving from Windows 7 to Windows 8. Have you heard that on the Information Week side?
Not in any significant numbers. I'm sure there are a handful, but if they're doing it, they're not talking about it very much.
Exactly. Yeah, that's been my take. Windows 8.1 is actually, it's a decent operating system. I've been using it for, 2 years now. But even though I like it on my personal systems, even though I like it on my production systems, I haven't even thought about upgrading the enterprises that I control from Windows 7 because Windows 7 has been such a good fit. Now, Chiebert, let me ask you this. Does this make Windows 8 officially Vista?
Yeah. Yeah. Don't get me wrong. Windows 8, I actually kind of like it. You know, it works. I do admit that one of the first things I add is a classic start button so I can get the start button back. But it's not a bad operating system. It is faster, especially on certain platforms. And the drivers are significantly more stable, even though it will use the older Windows 7 drivers. Actually, it'll use drivers all the way back to a Vista timeframe. But Windows 8 is an orphan child. You know, it was one of those operating systems that was still under Steve Ballmer, and I don't think the consumer world has forgiven Ballmer for Metro. So Windows 10 is almost a kind of heading back to the Windows 7 world. And more importantly, the divisions within Microsoft have had a lot more time to integrate it in so that it's more enterprise-ish. Windows 8 was still pretty weak on the enterprise side. And all the pilot projects I heard were saying, okay, it's great on tablets, but I'm not going to move my enterprise. It's not worth it yet. Yeah. Windows 10, maybe.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that I've been seeing in the preview editions that I've been playing with is it plays much better with some of the network management, network deployment tools that I've been using for Windows 7. It also, and again, Chiebert, I think we were having a discussion about this. Right now, the versions that we're getting will work on non-UEFI machines, which is kind of nice, especially if you're doing a deployment for older machines. But as you said, it just plays friendlier. It plays well with IT managers, IT administrators. Now, Curtis, the question is for me would be, are they going to simplify licensing at all? Because Windows 8, not only was it sort of a disaster of an enterprise deployment, but it was very unfriendly as far as licensing terms were concerned.
Yeah, I think that we've already seen the company start to simplify its licenses when it comes to things like Windows 365, and I suspect that that's going to continue. This is a message that Microsoft has been hearing for years from its customers. Ballmer resisted because there were enough of its customers who were taking advantage of some of those Byzantine licensing strategies that it made economic sense for Microsoft to keep them in place. What we have now is the understanding that simpler is better, and that any small rises in the cost of the licenses can more than be offset in the minds of customers through simplifying the management of those licenses. So this is one of those cases where, like so much else in Microsoft, we're seeing a changing of the guard. And I strongly suspect that by the time Windows 10 actually rolls out, that it's going to be accompanied by some pretty significant changes in the licensing structure. My guess is that we'll see some big announcements around the time of the Gartner Symposium this fall.
Fantastic. Now, let's go ahead and jump into something that one of our hosts has some very unique and intimate information about, and that is HP Discover. That's right. There was a conference recently about all things HP, about their strategy, their product line, where they're going, what they're hoping to bring along into the enterprise. Curtis, tell me, what is HP Discover, and what did you do there?
Well, HP Discover is the big HP love fest that happens every year. Pretty much all of the vendors have these. Both hardware and major software companies have these, where they get the faithful, they get all their big customers, wine them and dine them, get potential customers in there to feel the good vibrations. HP did that this year, and most of the news was, if not surprising, at least consistent, although there were a couple of interesting points in there. Let's hit those interesting points first. This is the last HP Discover for one company. By the time next year rolls around, HP will be in two separate companies. One is going to be called Hewlett Packard Enterprise, and the other one is, you know, HP, which will have all of the consumer kinds of devices in it, the laptops, the desktops, the printers, things, and scanners, things like that. So this was the last time everybody gets together under one big tent, and they had announcements that a lot of people looked at. Now, one that has gotten a fair amount of traction and attention, of course, is the Sprout. This is the all-in-one that is made special by the fact that it includes a full-color 3D scanner. So, you know, they're getting heavily into the maker, into the prototyping space. And that whole technical space is important to them. In another arena, they got heavily into the technical aspect by touting all of the motion picture ties that they had. They had announcements around, for example, DreamWorks Studios. They're going to be using a lot of HP hardware and software. Lightstorm, 20th Century Fox, those are the people who brought us Avatar, are also going to be using HP gear to do all of the rendering and animation on the three upcoming Avatar sequels. So that's a big deal. Everybody wants to be in pictures. HP talked about faster storage, the HP 3PAR store serve, which is getting into the notion that enterprise storage is going the way of flash. The cost differences between solid state storage and spinning magnetic storage are dropping to the point that high-performance storage is going full bore into the SSD world. We've got HP LeanFT, which was HP's big functional testing suite. It's got a lot of play, and it sort of goes back to HP's roots. Here's an interesting aside. When I've been talking to HP people, I find that when they're talking about the new company and all the new exciting things they're doing, they tend to talk about HP. When they're talking about the technology, when they're talking about rediscovering their engineering side, they always refer to it as Hewlett Packard. Just an interesting little bit of terminology there. We had news on HP's Hellion cloud system. And, you know, it hasn't been all that long ago that we were hearing that HP was getting out of the public cloud market. Well, they're in, they're out, they're in, they're out. At Discover, they said, yeah, we're really in. And they expanded their support for multiple hypervisors, multiple cloud types. HP really wants to be the one cloud to rule them all. So if you've got Azure instances, if you've got AWS instances, HP says, that's fine. Keep them, add some Hellion, and use the Hellion Cloud System 9 manager to ride herd over all of them. And finally, HP talked about converged systems. Now, HP, Dell, IBM, everybody's been talking about converged systems for a while. HP really talked about HP OneView 2.0 management platform as being a way to keep a handle on all of the converged systems. And for those who might have missed it, converged systems are where you have the networking, storage, servers, kitchen sink, everything else in one rack. It's a big deal in data storage and data system design. And again, HP wants everyone to know that they're right there. So that's kind of what was going on at the whole HP Discover thing.
It's a sort of a Harry Potter's world of HP. Cheebert, I know that you've been wanting to get your hands on HP's 3D printer for a while. What makes it so drool-worthy in your eyes?
Well, first off, it's got a much, much bigger build volume than most of the systems on the market today. In addition, it's going to be sold just like HP inkjet printers. They're going to make the hardware reasonably cheap. Not sure what reasonable is going to be because this is a massive, massive printer. But they're going to make up their money on the consumables. And the consumables are what's really special. One, they're starting off with nylon, which is actually a pretty advanced thermoplastic in itself. But it's CMYK. So my geologists and planetary scientists are absolutely drooling because now they can do full color topo maps. You'll be able to, it's designed so that a corporation could have one and you could walk in and say, order a new rear view mirror in the color of your car, or you can order a new hairbrush, or you can order this or that. It's going to, what HP hopes, change the way we deliver product to the end user, because now you can print it on demand.
We've got JJ to the 4884 in the chat room saying, boo to proprietary 3D printer cartridges, but HP is going a slightly different route than other companies that have decided to DRM their filaments. They're not just saying, we're going to give you ABS or PLA, but with a chip so that you can only use our products. They're actually giving you new choices in the filaments that they use. That I'm actually okay with. I mean, that's if you're going to give me something extra, then I'm willing to pay a little extra for it. Now, unfortunately, we do have to say goodbye to Cheebert. Cheebert has a conference he has to get to, so we're going to wave goodbye to the geek in paradise. Cheebert, really quickly, could you please tell the folks at home where they might be able to find you and your work in this coming week?
This coming week, I'm going to be hiding because I got to go and deploy some more power sensors. By the way, the HP multi-jet technology isn't filament, it's powder. And the filament-based systems, you know, maybe 100 micron resolution. No, the HP is going to be 30 micron resolution, which is really, really exciting.
Cheebert, if you get one of those, I am going to have to fly back over there just to play with it.
Dude, I'm in line for a grant.
Okay. I think that's probably the only way we're going to be able to afford one of those.
Yeah, who knows? My dean's getting excited, though.
Ladies and gentlemen, Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii. Cheebert, we'll see you next week for another episode of TWiET.
Bye, guys.
Now, when we come back, we're going to be bringing in Karl Auerbach. He's a friend of the show. He's been on before. He's been working with DARPA, I don't know, maybe doing some robots, Skynet, Terminator. You know, you might need to pay attention. But before we do that, let's go ahead and thank the second sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Now, let me ask you a question. Are you hiring? Because if you are, you do know that your employees are, well, what make your business. An employee can make or break a business. The talent that you bring into your business is what's going to decide what your next great product is or your next great service. Well, you could hire the old-fashioned way. You could put an ad in the paper. You could maybe go to a job site or two. Maybe post to Craigslist. Yes, that might bring in a few people, but as we know, that won't really get you the quality people that you need, the quality pool of candidates so that you can choose the one with the right qualifications and the right culture for your business, which is why we're happy to have ZipRecruiter as a sponsor of this week in Enterprise Tech. Now, ZipRecruiter understands that posting your job in one place or just a few places isn't enough to find those quality candidates. With ZipRecruiter.com, you post your job once and it gets placed on 100-plus job sites. And it gets instantly matched to candidates from over 4 million resumes. You just post once, and within 24 hours, you can watch the qualified candidates roll into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface, which lets you make the right decisions about hiring in the least amount of time. Now, find out today why ZipRecruiter has been used by over 400,000 businesses. You can try ZipRecruiter today with a free 4-day trial, and it lets you get that perfect candidate before he or she goes to somebody else. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. That's ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. And we thank ZipRecruiter for their support of this week in Enterprise Tech. We welcome back to the show the cave bear himself, Mr. Karl Auerbach. Karl, thank you very much for coming back on to Twyatt.
Hi. Let me get this wire off my shoulder. Okay.
Now, we have been talking about getting you back on the show for a while, but you have been busy. You've been very, very busy. In fact, for the last 20 months working on an interesting project with a very off-known government agency known as DARPA. Can you tell us a little bit about what the robotics challenge is?
Well, actually, DARPA has something like 350 projects going on right now. For example, discovering security flaws and automatically patching them. Seems like some other government bodies could use that technology. What they are doing with DARPA is one of several robotics projects, and DARPA Robotics Challenge is, well, everybody knows the subtext is robotic soldiers, but nobody talks about that. The triggering event was the Fukushima meltdowns. You can't send people into those reactors. Apparently, the bottom is filled with melted stuff that has got the name corium. As solidified on the bottom, all highly radioactive, people can't go in there. That and fires, collapsed buildings, earthquakes, tsunamis, what kind of disaster of du jour, it's really dangerous for people to go in there. So DARPA had the bright idea of saying, well, why don't we try to encourage people to design robots that can go along with firefighters and other first responders and go into the places first, into the dangerous places, and do some of the more dangerous jobs so that when people enter, they won't be subject to such risk. The requirements for this are that the robots be big enough that they actually can do something, because it does take strength when you're inside a place like that. You've got to go deal with debris and doors. And also, whenever you have a disaster, communications are questionable. You may not have a solid link. So what DARPA was trying to do was encourage robots to be somewhat autonomous. They could deal with situations which they only had seen in rough detail, not tight detail, but only in general. And without human teleoperation, without a user sitting behind a camera turning a steering wheel. My job there was not the robotic side. It was to do what I do best, which is to break things. So my job was to mess up the network in a controlled way to make sure that the teams had a really hard time doing remote control of their robots. In particular, when the robots were inside, what scene you're showing right now, getting out of the ATV, that was considered outside. When the robot went through a door, which you'll see later in the track, we turned the communications almost completely off. While they were outside, they were getting a 300 megabit feed from the robot. When they went inside, that was chopped, except once every 30 seconds, we would open it up for 1 second. And during that 1 second, they had to snapshot their visual and three-dimensional data. Now, you're looking at a door right now. Now that they didn't know whether that door was going to pull or push or have a doorknob or a lever. And in some cases, the wind was blowing on it so that if you pushed on the door, you might have to push really hard. So you had to distinguish between pulling and pushing. There were a lot of problems these robots had to solve on their own. And you can see that he's having trouble even grasping a doorknob. There was one robot from CMU that was so strong that during the preliminaries that we did in South Carolina, it almost knocked the entire wall over.
Well, that's one way to open the door.
You could.
Carl, it's interesting because so these robots were designed, ostensibly they were designed. We know they're going to head towards combat, but obviously they're not ready. The video that we're watching right now shows we're still a couple of generations away from robots you could reliably put out in the battlefield. But as you mentioned, Fukushima or Chernobyl, where they've got those fuel-containing masses in an erect building, you would need some sort of robotic system that can be disconnected from communications because of high radiation and would still be able to continue the job. That's essentially what you were duplicating, right? You were duplicating loss of connectivity.
And also that last video you showed was from the Florida event 2 years ago, where we had tethers for the robots to hold them up in case they fell. This last run, there were no tethers. If the robot fell, it fell. It could not get back up, except on its own. If it did fall, we stopped the clock. We gave it a 10-minute penalty out of its time, and we helped it get up. But it had to be essentially on its own. And remember, it's also carrying all of its power.
Right, right.
That particular robot's carrying close to 60 pounds of batteries.
You know, the interesting thing is, if you're listening to this podcast, download the video version, because just a while ago, we were watching a robot trying to get out of a car, and you're kind of rooting for it. It's taking those baby steps towards the edge, and it finally gets down to the ground, and it's sort of a relief of, okay, good, it could handle that situation. Oh, Carl, tell me, what kind of programming goes into making a robot that's aware enough to be able to solve a problem like, I'm not on the ground, I need to get down onto the ground, or there's a door, I kind of know how to open a door, I need to find the knob, what do I look for? How did the different teams go about it?
Well, that's the secret sauce that the different teams had. The basic Atlas robot from Boston Dynamics came with that's the big robot, the hydraulic robot that you saw from IHMC there. Several teams used that robot, and as I understand, they mostly threw out the Boston Dynamics software and put in their own. I have no clue how that software works. I saw all kinds of imagery and things, but it's pretty magic. Now, a lot of those robots had a lot of horsepower on board. One of them I saw was carrying a half dozen i7s on it, and the power for it. Once they discovered they didn't have a horsepower, they had to add more i7s, more power supplies, more power. They needed to build a stronger robot. So just a change of processing meant a bigger, stronger robot. And some of the other robots, particularly the winning team, seemed to use a more distributed architecture. They gave more autonomy to each joint. And if you start thinking about that, that's how biological entities seem to be. When a human falls, I don't know what trick kicks into play, but there's stuff happens that I don't think about. I start protecting myself. My arms go in certain positions. And it isn't just high-level intelligence like humans. Cats know how to jump and land very well. It seems that there are, in biological entities, that there's a lot of distributed functions that are highly specialized for things like balance and perception of objects, things like that. Right now, our computing model, we've learned how to compute in central processing systems. We haven't really learned how to distribute that in real time to a device such as a robot. Because as you're seeing on the screen here, a robot's trying to balance on some bricks. That's really easy for me. I did the entire course in 38 seconds in South Carolina, except for driving the ATV. But it takes a long time for a robot to do that. They have to stop and think and measure their balance. Yet for us and most biological entities, maintaining balance is a pretty basic thing. I mean, even chickens can run around and can maintain their balance when their heads are cut off.
Right, right.
So yeah, we've got a lot to learn.
It really is amazing when you consider, you know, all the things that we do that these robots are trying to do. In fact, I'm sure you've seen there's a YouTube cut down of, it was like a minute and a half of just the DARPA robots falling down. Because they're trying to open a door wrong, or because they're taking the wrong step, or because something just breaks. And we do that without even thinking. That's it's almost automatic when I go to open a door. All the different things that I'm doing with my body to balance it properly so I can put enough leverage onto that door. You're right. That has to be done step by step by step. And you see how painstakingly slow it can be.
And just think of the calculations going on. When a robot puts out its arm, it's changing its balance. And those arms on those robots are fairly heavy. Well, a human arm is also pretty heavy. That robot that just fell over, the CMU one, that robot weighs over something like 450 pounds. That one that's falling right now is a fairly lightweight one. Good. I think that was close to 100 pounds. That one's about 200 pounds.
Could any of these self-right? When any of these robots yes, were able to get? They could. Whoa. Wow.
The CMU one, the tartan one, which is the red one that they called the chimp, that one was able to get itself back up. And there goes the IHMC robot.
Oh, you always want to cry. Don't fall over, little robot.
You know, falling breaks them because they're not really designed.
Right.
And the one of the robots did break a something and was able to, I think it was the IHMC one, and just simply switched hands. I mean, they don't have left hand, right hand. They're able to switch things around.
Now, it's funny because people look at this and they go, oh, those silly robots. But as you mentioned, just two years ago at the Florida competition, the robots were tethered. Now they're untethered. What's the next step, Carl?
Well, this was the finish of this round of DARPA trials. This was meant to be a 2 or 4 year program, and it's now over. I don't know what DARPA is going to do next. I'm sure they have several other programs in mind, but they've definitely got their job is to prime the pump and see what comes out of it. Mm. And if they think something else needs priming, they will put money into that. They've got lots of ideas, and they've got, as I said, they have like 300 projects going on. So they're a very busy organization trying to do all kinds of things. I talked to somebody down there who's got a DARPA project to build green rocket fuels, green solid fueled boosters that don't use chemicals they're green all the way around.
Right, right.
Just don't be under it when it comes down.
Well, I mean, when you say that this is supposed to prime the pump, does that mean that a lot of this research is going to be made available, or does it just mean that the teams who participated now have a nice leg up on everybody else?
I do not know. We know like the ARPANET technology all came out, but on the other hand, these teams were quite competitive. The Japanese teams, the Hubu robot that was used by a couple of teams that was also used by the winning KAIST team, is commercially produced. You can go buy one. You'll have to program it yourself. And Google's clearly doing something with robots. They had the winning team from Florida, but they weren't here this time. They've gone and locked themselves up in secrecy. I assume there were lots of patent rights and things like that. The word I heard about that was that people were just too busy to write the patent applications. So I don't really know what's going to come out. We did see that the CMU team, I kind of knew it was happening when in South Carolina was chatting with them. They said, you know, Uber moved into our building. So I was half expecting the announcement that came out 2 weeks ago that Uber had hired away most of their team to build robotic taxis.
Carl, one big question here that I know that our audience is going to want, which is, how did you get involved with this? I know you've been working with DARPA for quite a while, but how did you get roped into being part of this project?
Well, as you know, I like to break things, and I'm really good
yes,
at it.
Yes, you are.
So my company, Interworking Labs, we took an idea from John Postel, which is, we used to have these TCP/IP bake-offs, and Postel said, we need a box that does things wrong, a man-in-the-middle box that does things wrong. He called it a flakeway. And when I started a video company back in the mid-1990s, we built this code, and we needed a box that did things wrong so we could test all our algorithms for receiving video and audio packets in all kinds of relative timings and shapes and forms. It's really hard to do. So eventually I decided to build that, and I eventually did. So this company we have, Interworking Labs, one of our testing products is a line of boxes that you can put in the middle. It's basically looks like an Ethernet bridge. And you can do simple things like dropping packets or inducing rate limitation or resequencing packets or what have you, or more complex things like reframing IP packets in bigger Ethernet frames. That trips up a lot of people, or rewriting protocol fields like changing putting in IP options into packets, or fooling with a TCP handshake, making it from a three-way handshake into a four-way handshake, which is totally legal, but people rarely see it. So we tend to tickle people's implementation and cause them to break so they don't end up shipping out product and then having it break in the field. We did have a customer who said, looked at our IPv6 test and said, we only have an IPv4 test here, so we'll use our box, which has 100, 200, 300,000 units in the field. It's obviously works perfectly. We hooked it up and died within 30 seconds. So we have a reputation of being able to do these things. DARPA somehow heard about us. We got involved in the trials down in Florida where we used some smaller units where we did various things to the robots. We discovered after that we needed to impose more severe restrictions because in Florida, people were remote control driving the robots to a large extent. And the goal was push more intelligence into the robots. So our goal here in Pomona at the finals was not to really emulate a disaster situation network to the utmost perfection. As Tolstoy would say, that all disasters networks are different. But our goal was to create a typical condition that would drive the teams to a strategy in which they had to put more intelligence in the robot to give it essentially a goal and say, you're on your own, robot. You have to figure out how to open this door. We can give you a limited amount of assistance, but in general, you, robot, have to be able to do that. And we'll talk to you in 30 seconds. There was a continuous connection at low bandwidth, but the main connection for sensor data, telemetry data, everything you really not want coming back from the robot, that was substantially restricted for most of the run.
Of course.
So the robots are only able to essentially give 3D information and visual information to their teams once every 30 seconds.
And that's how to prevent them from going after Sarah Connor. Now, let me go ahead and bring in my co-host here, Curtis. One of the tie-ins that we have to make here is, you know, people are going to look at this and say, okay, DARPA, interesting robotics challenge, very interesting project, but where is the application in the enterprise? But of course, both of us know that this kind of intelligence is already being used by, say, Amazon, by some other big retailers. Where do you see this kind of smarts being used in contemporary enterprise networking?
Well, I see that we're going to be using robots in many, many more areas within the enterprise. You correctly point out that Amazon has been at the forefront of using robotics in a warehousing and distribution environment. I suspect that we're going to see them begin to use robotics outside the confines of the warehouse walls. When they talk about things like drone delivery systems, they're talking about robotics. Manufacturing has seen robotics use. We're going to see much more of that. We've had robotics used for years in things like delivering mail and packages in office buildings. That's going to continue. And I think what we're probably going to see is more and more of robotics acting as personal assistants, or thought of in another way, intelligent robotics used as vehicles that carry your intelligent personal assistant with them. You know, personal assistants are things that we've heard Google and Apple talking about quite a great deal in their recent conferences. That's going to be a growing set of things. And it's fascinating that we're talking about this today. I recently heard a conversation very similar to this on the BBC, where they were talking about what's happening in Europe. So this isn't just the U.S. and people in Silicon Valley talking about robotics being used in more and more situations. It's happening worldwide. Now, in terms of things like bipedal locomotion, I think that that's going to take a while because, as Carl has alluded to, it's a really difficult mobility problem. So most of the enterprise robots are going to continue to use something that they're familiar with, wheels or tracks or something that doesn't involve the advanced balancing that so many people are still working on. But in terms of the intelligence of the mission of those robots, that's going to be growing pretty darn quickly.
We are approaching the end of our time here, but I did want to give Carl one last stab at this. I saw you holding up something to the camera. What was that?
Oh, a robotic shark. Okay. It was there. It runs. It was funded by our friends at DHS. The purpose is for it to swim around harbors and inspect the bottom of ships. It has a fin on top that contains a GPS and a Wi-Fi unit. It swims to the top, signals out what it's collected, and asks for new instructions. This thing is deployed now. It's apparently swimming around harbors of the USA today. It'll go down several hundred feet and can travel for several hours underwater. I also saw robotic snakes for crawling through various kinds of debris. The options, or the places where this stuff can be used, are just amazing. It's really a matter of imagination. The distinction between what robots have been used in the past is these are meant to operate in a fairly unstructured environment where they don't follow like the Honda robots. That's really a definitely choreographed robot. It knows its environment. It doesn't get surprised. These robots are intended to be surprised and deal with it like people do. That's the main difference. That's the big step here. It's not so much the robots. We've had robots for a long time. These are robots with a lot more flexibility, a lot more autonomy, and even the bordering of some degree of artificial intelligence.
Wait, robot sharks and snakes. They're not actually making their characters from bad sci-fi movies, are they? Because
did you see the NASA robot? Their Mars robot.
Yes.
It wasn't so different. It was just very female.
Yes, it was. Probably a little bit too much. Well, gentlemen, I'm afraid that we have reached the end of our time. That's right, folks. You have used up another hour listening to the best dang enterprise podcast in the universe. That's according to 9 out of 10 robots. I want to thank, of course, my guest for being on here. Carl, it is always a pleasure to have you on. You can regale us with tales of everything from way back when to the future of robotics. Could you please tell the folks at home where they could find you and find your work?
I'm in Santa Cruz, California. And my company is IWL.com, shows right in the bottom of the screen there. And my personal is cavebear.com, and you can read all about my liberal politics there. And I'll be at the great mandolin shows that are coming up this week in Santa Cruz. If you want a great show for mandolin music, it's happening this next week. That's where to find me.
I got to head up to Santa. I haven't been to Santa Cruz in probably 2 years. I got to head up and I'll say hi. The next time I come up, when I have cheaper, I'll drag him along.
Okay.
Fantastic. Also, thanks to my co-host, at least the remaining co-host on the line, Mr. Curtis Franklin. Curtis, thank you for making the best out of a bad Wi-Fi situation. It is always a pleasure to have you on. Could you please tell the folks what they can expect from Information Week Radio this coming week?
Well, we've got lots of interesting stuff going on, and I'm continuing to write for InformationWeek.com. As a matter of fact, this weekend I've got a piece coming out on the once and future COBOL, talking about COBOL. And we've also got a feature that we're asking for our readers' help with. What's in your IT bag? IT pros carry all kinds of interesting bags with all kinds of interesting stuff in them. We'd love to know what works for you in terms of what you carry around and what doesn't. So head on over, look for that article on informationweek.com, and let me know what you think. We'd love to have your voice in that. And as always, you can keep up with Information Week Radio and my work at Information Week through following me on Twitter. I'm at KG4GWA.
Thanks again, Curtis. And folks, thank you. That's right, the person who comes back each week to listen or watch This Week in Enterprise Tech. We wouldn't have a show without you. And so we want to make it easier for you to get our episodes. If you just go to our show page at twit.tv/twiet, you'll be able to find a little drop-down menu so you can subscribe. That means you can get our audio version, our video version, our high-definition video version into the device of choice. Now, you may notice that we've got a brand new website, so it may take you a little bit of time to navigate and figure out where everything is, but it's made to provide a better Twit experience. I also want to thank everyone here who makes this show possible. Of course, to Lisa and to Leo for letting me do this week in Enterprise Tech. To Carson, my super producer. And, of course, yes, Zach, my TD. Zach, could you please tell the folks where they can find you on the Twit TV network?
Thank you, Padre. You guys can find me on Twitter at Eskimo Zach, spelled with an H. And I didn't have any inputs on the TriCaster for our camera today.
Yeah, thank you, okay. Padre. We'll get you next week. Of course, thanks to you and to everyone who keeps coming back week after week. Don't forget that you can find our show every Friday, 1 o'clock p.m. Pacific time, live.twit.tv. As long as you're watching live, go ahead and jump into our chat room at irc.twit.tv. I've got you on a screen right down there, so if you want to talk back to me or to my guests, that's a great place to do it. Until next time, I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the Digital Jesuit. And just remember, if you want to know what's going on in the Enterprise, just keep quiet. Yeah.